Thank you everyone for being here and letting me crash your inTouch event. Again, my name is David Garibaldi. I'm an artist from Sacramento, California. And before we get started, I just want to show you a quick video just so you can kind of get an idea whether you've seen what I do or not, but to sort of help explain a little bit.
He is a tremendous artist, and the way he presents it is phenomenal. You never know what the final image is going to be until then.
It's not just about the painting, everything else involved that makes it so
good. Like a game show, I'm sitting on the edge of my seat going, what is it? What is it? Oh my gosh, what's that?
So for our breakdown, I'm a performance painter. I create these large images with paint and brushes in minutes to music. And but I actually started off doing paintings much larger, sometimes faster, depending on the situation. Now, it was graffiti, and it was illegal, but I was young, I was impressionable, I was into hip-hop culture, and at that time, if you were an artist or creative and you were in hip-hop culture, you sort of went the route of graffiti. Now, there was one night that just completely changed my perspective about this path of graffiti. Now, it started off with the clicking of spray cans, and then it soon ended with the sound of sirens. So I was out at a rail yard, probably not too far from here, but with some friends. I was probably 14 or 15 at the time, and all of a sudden, we heard the sirens, and a foot race began between myself and my friends and one of Sacramento's fastest policemen. I think he's like on their track rec team. I don't know. He was fast. So we started running, and there was this 8-foot stone wall between two very different scenarios. One, going home with him. The other, making it on the other side of this wall and hopefully being the last time that this scenario would ever happen. So luckily, I made it over this wall. And I told myself a few things. First thing was, David, you need to lose weight. Actually, it sounded more like, you need to lose weight. It's probably more like that. The second thing was, you need to make some new friends that are not bringing the situations that you're running from the police. And then the third thing was a question. It was, David, what are you doing with this creativity that was given to you? You didn't ask for it. You didn't buy it. You stole some things, but you didn't steal that. So what are you doing with this creativity, this gift that was given to you? And that, and I, this has happened, and I remember that just sitting with me for a couple weeks. It was in the summer. School had started, and I walked into the classroom of Mr. Sullivan. Now, Mr. Sullivan, just to describe, stands about 10 feet tall, fiery red hair, red eyes beaming into my soul, and I remember seeing him, and I feel like he knew everything I stole and painted on, and but no, he's much more kind than how he looks. But you know, he said, David, I get what you're doing, you know, with the graffiti. I understand that was kind of a natural path for you, but you know, can I show you how to bring your paintings to life and just to use them in a more positive way? He's like, if you just give me this next year to just show you that you can still get the better recognition than painting on toilets and trash cans, that you would change. And his challenge was, the more time you spend in the classroom creating, the less time you spend in the streets painting. So I took him up on this deal, and I was learning not only how to do animation and figure drawing, but I was also learning the art of storytelling, how to cut and edit sound, and to really use color to tell stories. And my original stories were about this kid being running from the police and making it over this wall. It was like what was happening at that time. But I was just using these new tools that were given to me. And I think at that time, just for me, being open to it, being open to being trained, to being a student, and it completely changed my life and the direction of it. But unfortunately for me, as cool as that sounds, like, all right, positives, kids got a new direction. When it came time to graduate, all that time that I had was messing around and wasn't paying attention, I wasn't able to graduate on time. So I was like in this place now. I was like, great, I have this new direction and I'm feeling good. I'm doing art in a positive way, and I still can't graduate on time. It's very frustrating, especially for a kid that said, I'm going to give my teacher this you know, all this time, and it still didn't work out. But something in me still stuck with me, that these tools that I learned, this passion that Sullivan really helped bring out of me. So I finished up high school, and after high school I was still working odd jobs. I didn't go to art school right away, and I was sort of moving around from place to place. But eventually I had lost my job, my car was repossessed, and I was about to be evicted from my little apartment that was it was about the size of this screen up here. It was very small. Got inside of it, went to bed, ate, did everything in that little apartment. But I had this moment, another moment with myself. The first one was out of breath over the wall. This one was just sitting in this apartment that I was about to be evicted from. And I just thought, you know, what is the one thing that can't be taken from me? What was that one thing that was instilled in me that I have to now put to use? And that was that creativity again. So I went and bought my first brushes, my first paints. I bought them, did not steal them. And I started teaching myself how to paint legally this time. And I was inspired still by hip hop culture and music. And so I would go to these little jazz clubs. Has anyone been to the Fox and Goose? I love their brunch. I love their brunch. And their beer, of course. And I went to the Fox and Goose, and they would have these jazz nights. And then there'd be a band that would set up, and I'd bring my little tiny easel and canvas, and I'd sit there and I'd paint. And then after the show, people would ask me, that's a really cool painting, can I buy it? And I'm like, $300. And they're like, I'll give you 25 bucks. I'm like, sold. Take it, please. Cash? All right, good. And I started doing this early on, and probably did this for about 6 months, where I would, you know, start selling these paintings. And it was still very, 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 very hard to do. But I just love to create, and I thought, okay, I'm just gonna do this. As long as it takes, I wanna create to survive, in a sense. I was just sort of getting by and surviving. So a few months passed, I was at a friend's house, and I remember sitting on his couch, much, much bigger apartment, about the size of this room. But across the room, there was this painting on the wall, and I remember when I walked up close to it, it was just splattered and splashed together, and then when I stepped back, it was this beautiful portrait of Jimi Hendrix. And I asked my friends, how did this artist splash this painting together, but it still looks like Jimmy? Well, he said the artist's name was Denny Dent, and Denny Dent was a performance painter. He was the first. He called himself a rock and roll painter. So he got up and he like started jumping around. He's like, yeah, he's got like paint and he's throwing it around, and then it looks like Jimmy. I'm like, wow, I wanna do that. That sounds great. So I was in that moment. I was so inspired. It was movement, it was color, it was music, it was all these things in my life that led up to that moment. Because growing up, I was always into music. I played the trumpet for some amount of years. Don't ask me to play it now because it won't sound great. I was into dance in high school. I got into like break dancing and hip hop dancing, and I was always into art. So it was all these things. So the next day I was now living with my dad because I got evicted, and I was in his garage just sort of like throwing paint around, and it wasn't going well, but he would come outside to see what I was working on. I'm like, Dad, you know, what do you think? And he would just like have this blank stare in his face and take a breath and say, like, it's my son's life. Just like dripping down the wall. I was like, no, Dad, what do you think? He's like, I don't know, it's a great Chewbacca. I love it. I was like, it's Bob Marley, but I could see that influence in it. So I obviously needed a lot of work, and if it involved art or creativity or movement, I was very self-motivated to get into it. And eventually I was performing on stages and local stages, and I started off, it's now called Ace of Spades, but back in the day it was called Empire. It was a nightclub, and I sort of hustled my way to convince the owner to let me perform every single Friday. We had like a contract that made out of crayon. I was like, just handprint there and it's a deal. So I would do that every Friday, and every Friday I would sort of hone these skills, and eventually what it turned into was this performance painting show that I called Rhythm and Hue. And I started off local, just doing sort of local companies and charities and events and concerts, and then eventually I started getting calls to travel outside of the city and then the state and then eventually the country. So I do have some more videos. Can I give you guys another little sample? This one, just fast forward a little bit, this was from when I was on America's Got Talent season 7. I believe this was the audition, so enjoy. Oh, actually, I'm sorry, I'm skipping ahead. Real quick, we can keep it off. These are just samples of some of the paintings that I create and also created back in the day. They're normally 6 foot tall in size and created in a couple of songs, which is about 5 minutes on average. So let me show you how it's. David Garibaldi and his CMYKs.
CMYKs.
Yes.
Nah, I don't know. What was his name?
Okay, it stands for cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. So it's 4 colors. When you mix them, you can create and do anything. I've been an artist my whole life. Growing up, I was into graffiti. I also was into dance. This is where I met these guys. We all met in a dance group out of Sacramento, California. With my background in graffiti, music, art, and dance, this is a combination of all of those things. When we're on stage, it's sort of like a controlled chaos.
Go get them! Hello.
Hello.
What's your name?
My name is David Garibaldi, and they are my CMYKs.
And where are you from?
We're from Sacramento, California.
Sacramento, California. You think what you're going to show us is worth $1 million?
I have the faith that yes.
Okay, show us.
Now, I'm going to come back to that because later on, I'm just going to talk about something what I call sort of turning your challenges into changes. And the beginning of sort of auditioning for America's Got Talent presented a very, very interesting challenge. So I'll get back to that. But along the way, when I started traveling more and performing, started performing for larger companies instead of the local bar and grills. So some of them just up here, these are clients. So from ESPN to Disney, Nestle, Cirque du Soleil, and the NBA, and the list goes on. And what's crazy is the variation of the shows, which was everything from a private party at a private home in Aspen for about 6 people to flying to Paris to open up for Sting at the Olympia Theater. And it would just vary. We just got back from, we did a show in New York called Life in Color. It's a big EDM sort of electronic music concert, and there's about 15,000 people, and there's like actually paint flying into the audience, and I'm like, where have you been all my life? Like, these are my people. So the list varies, and I think it's very interesting just how we've been able to go between sort of a corporate world and also sort of these private and intimate settings as well. Just how art has sort of transcended that. Now. Also, along the way, as I begin this journey of what I called rhythm and hue and things were going well, and I thought, okay, we're traveling, we're doing about 80 to 100 shows a year, and we're entertaining. And I still thought it could be more, because I noticed that we were taking only a few hundred dollars in materials on stage. It's only a few minutes to a few songs. And at these charity events, these paintings would be auctioned off for tens of thousands of dollars before they were dry. So I thought, okay, not only do I want to entertain now, is I want to entertain, benefit, and inspire. I have this unique platform to just paint and perform this creativity again that I realized it was given to me from a higher purpose, and I want to use it for something more than just making people scream. We like to make them scream, that's cool. But it could be more. And I set this goal. Actually, before I get to that, so I had this passion to create, and that's when I realized, when I applied this purpose behind it, that that's when we can start changing the world around us. So I set this goal to raise $1 million by the time I turned 30. And that was through the sales of my artwork and through the auction of my artwork. And I was about 26 years old at that time, so that's 4 years to do about $1 million off the sales of my artwork. So I set this goal, and it was a pretty daunting goal, but I figured I'd done a little research. I don't do a lot with numbers, but I did enough to find out, I think we can do this. So each year we set a goal to raise a certain amount of money, and I remember we were at $250,000, and I'm like, I think we might do this. And then I remember getting halfway to about $500,000, and I think I started doubting myself. I was like, I don't know if we're actually gonna make this. You know, these challenges that we sort of put on ourselves to use what we're doing every day for something bigger. And I think for us, it wasn't about changing what we did, because we can just take $1 million and give it away, and or whatever amount, $10. But I wanted to find a way to sustain giving. I didn't want to just do one charity show a year. I wanted to figure out, how can we do something for charity and use what we do almost every single day to entertain, benefit, inspire, to sustain giving. And it was applying this purpose behind performance painting, this passion of painting, that kept us going, kept us motivated. So I remember it was after America's Got Talent, or right before it ended, we were actually at a show. We had done fundraisers all over the world, but we were at a show at the Crocker Art Museum in downtown Sacramento. And I can't remember the company name, but they were putting it on. And I told them, you know, as I told the audience, I think if we raise $30,000 tonight off these three paintings, we'll reach our $1 million goal tonight. So I presented that challenge. I was like, if we don't, it's all good. Like, someone's still gonna benefit from this. But I just threw it out there. And I remember that the first painting, a gentleman just stood up and he just said $30,000. Wow. And I'm glad the painting looked good, because I'd hate to have a painting on his wall. He's like, I paid $30,000 for that. So there are some very, very generous people here in the city of Sacramento. And I was grateful. I think we ended up raising, almost $60,000 that night off the three paintings. So it was just a huge, huge blessing to meet that goal. To go from envisioning, I'm going to use something that I do every day, my platform, for something bigger, to inspire people. One day at a time, one meeting at a time, one relationship at a time, one brushstroke at a time, with this purpose behind each and every single thing. Now, I kind of mentioned earlier that, you know, when you set any sort of daunting goal or task, it doesn't come easy. It comes with many, 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 many challenges. And so this is over. I've been doing it now for about 11 years professionally. I'm 31 now. And I mentioned earlier the audition for America's Got Talent. So when we first got approached to audition, I thought, great, I'll just need about 6 minutes on stage and everything will be fine. They're like, no. You have 90 seconds. All right, okay, we can do that. I had no idea. I mean, pushing 4 minutes and 30 seconds for a quality piece of art still was just insane to me. So a minute and a half to paint, perform, and create an experience. This was probably the biggest challenge I've had up to this date. And this is beyond, we would do shows where they'd be like outside in the wind, sand flying, and there's two people there. And you know, there were some other weird situations, but this was probably the hardest, the weirdest. So I went to my studio in between shows, I'm still doing shows, and it took about 3 months to figure out how to do one painting in 90 seconds. Every day. Could you imagine going to work every day and your boss is like, all right, I need you to figure out how to you know, change this system, and you know, this is your date, and you're thinking, this is impossible. And every day leading up to the date, it doesn't happen. You don't get any closer. You just feel like you're getting further and further away from this goal. You're like, oh, I'm gonna get fired. You just start looking for new jobs right away. And like, you just present to your boss, like at the end, you're just thinking, okay, I'm just gonna say, you know, you're gonna quit. Because it just seems so impossible every single day for 3 months. I remember we were a week out from the audition, still hadn't figured it out. We were at 2 minutes, but we would have been disqualified. I was like, and I told my team, that was another important thing too, was not only reinventing how I did something for 8 years, the same way, the same brushes, the same setup, the same canvas, completely changing it, new brushes, new paint, a new approach, a new speed, but also now utilizing a team. You guys saw the dancers, the CMYKs. I had to start thinking, I've got to start bringing my team into this to help. I couldn't do this alone. So we kind of gave everyone a section to work on. Some guys, all they did was just jump and throw paint, but it was on there and I could smear it. I was like, close enough. I was like, all right, this guy, I need you to throw it in that section so just so I can move it around. So we start innovating. This is all now within the week and a half before. And then we're like, all right, we can't just paint. We gotta dance. We gotta put on a show. So anyways, all in all, we kind of got it. We practiced a lot. And I remember showing up to the audition before, and I told the guys, like, look, if this doesn't happen, we spent 3 months at least trying really, really hard to change something that we've done for years. We've transformed ourselves through this process. We've learned what we can and can't do. So no matter what, before we go out there, thank you guys for dedicating yourself as a team together. And we went out there and you guys saw what happened. We got a standing ovation, we went to Vegas and so on. We made it to the finals and came in fourth place and lost to Dogs. I'm not bitter at all. It's okay. No, but what came out of that was really exposing art to the world. I remember when we left the stage the last time, I said, you know, that really the point of this was to inspire people around the world, but also to know that art was for all people. And kind of going back to that, putting a purpose behind that passion. So let me just, I have another video for you guys. I like videos.
The start, he was there, he was there. In the end, he'll be there, he'll be there. And after night comes a light.
So that video was shot at Bayside Church, not too far from here. And I remember when I did it, I don't know what was happening in my life at the time, but I get very emotional when I watch that, just because I remember what was happening in my life at that time. But that video went on to get tens of millions of views online out of all the videos that I'd done, like 90-second paintings, and this painting was done in multiple pieces, but this one that was so personal, and I realized that this purpose that I wanted to put behind this passion I had to create was what mattered and what was worked. So whether I had gone on this journey and been around the world, or whether I had only done a few bar and grills like I joked around earlier, but I think the point of it is knowing that you have a platform that you come to or you go to every day, or maybe you go on the weekends, it's a group that you're part of, but you start changing the world one day at a time when you can take something that you're passionate about. You don't need someone to tell you to do this one thing. And this passion can be creative, it can be competitive, it can be charitable, profitable, scientific, mathematic. It can be wherever you love to go. And when this purpose, this reason that's bigger than you applied behind it, you start changing yourself, the people around you, and you start inspiring. And so, and obviously what I learned along this journey was bringing this team into it. Sometimes it's just me on stage, sometimes there's other people, but there's a lot of people behind the scenes that get me to that place as well. And so knowing that you're gonna need some people along the way, and I think that what I've seen around this building, Roy gave me a tour, and I saw all the snacks too. I got the tour, I was like, where do you keep the snacks? I wanna know. But really seeing how important relationships are. I know many of you are either with IMS or friends or family, or people that do business together with IMS, but I think that those relationships, I think that's that purpose. That's that thing that no matter what you do is a great, great thing to just drive that passion that you have. So I just have one more video to show you, and it's really just to show you that, sometimes we come to these places and we're like in life, and you're like, okay, I've done it. Like, what else is there to do? You know, I've achieved this certain part, or I've met all these goals, and I just want you to know that to keep dreaming, to keep thinking bigger. And I'm just gonna share with you sort of like, it's a video about sort of my dream about where we're taking performance painting and where we wanna take it to the next level. So I'm just gonna share that, but just keep in mind wherever you're at, if you feel like, no, I'm good. I want you to keep thinking bigger and to keep dreaming, so.
David Garibaldi and his CMYKs. Outstanding job. Step on over here. I know it's full of paint. Howard.
I'm gonna, before I play this next video, so I told you the first one took 3 months. There were five different rounds that we did. So the first one, 3 months, and then I think it was about a month or so, and then it was 3 weeks, and then about a week or so, this one, 3 days. And it was applying all these things that we had learned from this process of what not to do, what to do. But if you saw, there's one point where I'm putting the hair on, and there's a guy that sneaks up behind me to put some white on the eyes. That was, I just realized that when I was watching. I'm like, that is a great example of like using your team to create and to accomplish the goals that you have. So anyways, this is the next video is the one that I was telling you about just dreaming bigger. This new show, the Sight and Sound Experience, we're taking what is an old form of art, which is painting, and mixing it with this new technology of projection mapping. Creating the Sight and Sound Experience is a big sort of project. It was really the work of a team that brought this whole thing together. Music, video, stagehands, dancers. We found a way to create a sight and sound experience using painting and digital projection. Show is sort of unique in its own, you know, multiple canvases, some involve bigger, smaller canvases, and even characters on stage. Been done. So we're going into a new world, discovering new things, and also presenting our team with new challenges. So I just realized in that video I had paint on my face. I mean, I didn't know what paint was on my face at that time. But I mean, really, you know, what I want to leave you with is one, obviously, to keep dreaming bigger, and I think it's awesome that IMS brings all of you guys together for this, you know, to connect. And I think that whether it's here or beyond these walls, to just really keep connecting in relationships, and also that purpose, applying it to that passion, and that becoming the driving force. And I was watching this thinking, you know, would we have come to this place if we had never done stuff for charity or applied a bigger reason behind it? Maybe. But I really don't want to know, and I really don't care to think whether we would have done it or not, because along the way, you're already on this journey. Why not use it for a greater purpose? So thank you guys so much for having me. I appreciate it. Thank
you. It's just on that one video? No,
I don't know how many, but we've had sort of like over 10 million impressions, like YouTube impressions.
Wow.
So
that's
yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So
it's all my mom just clicking. Watch my son. He's a painter.
How many saw the Easter service at Bayside? Yeah. So I think that's online. I think you
yes.
can really see it. That was really phenomenal. That was really, really great thing.
Actually, what was phenomenal was the wind that day, because the whole thing fell over, and I was like, it's cool. We're going to keep going. It's cool, guys. It's not a big deal at all. So yeah, sorry.
Good cover.
Yeah, thanks.
Some questions.
Yes.
What happened to your paintings on America's Got Talent?
Interesting question. One of them was stolen.
Really?
The Mick Jagger. So quarterfinals, we did a painting on this plexiglass. I sprayed it all down with black, and it disappeared. And like, and we turned it around. So I was painting in reverse the whole time. So that we literally rolled it out back, and it rolled into someone's vehicle right after that.
Really?
The other are in my management's office in New York, and I think I have a couple in my studio down there. So maybe one day we'll gather them all up and we'll do a showing. somewhere, but yeah. Let me know if you see that other one on eBay, though. Let me know.
What drew you to the goal of 1 million by 30?
It was based on numbers that we were already doing. So it was thought out, but it was also beyond what I think at that time we could have done. So we had started keeping track probably a year or two before that. And I think just beyond the $1 million goal, we were already at a quarter of a million, just from, we're just going along, no goal. And I part of it personally, just my own personal journey, I had rededicated my life to Christ at the time. And so I was going through a lot of personal and spiritual changes. And I was sort of awakened by first looking at it that way, by, I don't want to change what I'm doing, I just want to change why. And so I'd seen what we had done, and then I was like, well, if we keep it this trend for a little bit, and then if we do extra on top of that, like there would be some times where we were getting close, I'm like, look, can we donate a painting somewhere? Because we need to get closer. So it was just all based on trends that we had seen, numbers, my team. Yeah.
Have you had an opportunity to go back to the teacher who kind of started that spark in your life?
Oh, yeah. We keep in touch all the time. Matter of fact, I'm probably gonna stop by his house today. He just had a surgery, so I'm gonna stop by. But yeah, probably all of those America's Got Talent performances, those are things that we've wanted to do for a long time. He probably came up with most of them. I remember he came in my office and or my studio, and he sat down. He's like, I'm like, all right. Takes a post-it note, folds it up, holds it up, and he's like, I was like, okay, you know, I'm gonna paint with a post-it note on national TV? He's like, no. He's like, so you paint in different panels, and then you put them together, and you hoist it up, and then you pull a string, and it falls. I'm like, oh, okay, so that's what we did the semifinals. We did a 16-foot Statue of Liberty in 90 seconds on multiple panels, came together, hoisted it up, and it fell down. So I was like, he's got some crazy stuff going on in a good way. But Mr. Sullivan, yeah, and I still call him Mr. Sullivan. He's like, come Sean. I'm like, I can't do that. So Sullivan is still a mentor today, and we keep in touch often.
Was he your art teacher in high school?
He was my animation teacher. I had different art teachers, but I probably spent a lot of time, more time in his class. Yeah.
Any others?
Oh, yes.
How many people have you painted already, and how many more do you have to go?
I have about 250 or maybe 300 images in my repertoire. So those are different images that I've created. And then, I mean, but there's still a lot of stuff that I want to do. Sometimes we'll go to events and they're like, you know, can you do what John Lennon and Mick Jagger, and they kind of make suggestions. But then there's times where I'm like, I always want to do a Mickey Mouse or a Spider-Man. So there's, I've done both of those, but there's a lot of images I haven't done yet. So I do about 80 to 100 shows a year. And it's about 3 to 4 paintings per show. So that doesn't include rehearsals or just personal paintings, but even then, I'm still like, there's more. I gotta do more. Yes.
There's only about 6 million.
You think I'd be in better shape.
There's only about 6 million people left, right, to paint?
That's true, yes, I guess. All of your faces.
Any other questions?
How about a new Mount Rushmore in paint?
Okay, I could just find a rock and paint it on there.
Yeah. Sounds just, like graffiti again.
Yeah, if we'll raise money for my legal fees, yes. Yeah. Yes.
Do you ever consider going back and mentoring any, you know, young kids who may have been maybe going through what you went through?
I do. I think definitely when I have the proper time to give them. We do. I've actually, when I started a lot, I would actually just perform and speak at high schools. That's all I did for probably 3 years straight. We go to high schools and we do this show. And imagine, like, it's your lunchtime or it's your the assemblies. You go in, you're like, great, another drunk driving speaker, which is not bad, but they're just expecting. And then there's this production, this show, and these four paintings, and we would share stories with them and meet them. But I think now if I'm not painting or traveling with my family, and so when I get proper time to do that, I would love to. So it's on my radar. Yes.
Awesome. Passion and purpose, and to accomplish that goal. Light and sound, kind of a new technology, something different. you asked mm-hmm. us to dream bigger, and I think that's so great. What is that next purpose, or what is something that you still hope to accomplish through what you're doing?
Well, I think on the passion side, I think it's, you know, now thinking of my medium as sound and color. So not just paint and canvas, but and music, but sound and color. So whether that's light or projection or and painting visuals. But I think the purpose is still the same. I think it's, you know, using, like I said, a few hundred dollars in materials and turning those paintings into something valuable for different charities. So for right now, nothing struck me, but I'm just gonna stick to that right now, where it's just the paintings raise money for those causes. And the passion side, I don't know, we'll see how weird that gets. So yeah, we'll see where that goes.
That's awesome. So you have two young ones, a four-year-old and a two-year-old, right?
Yes, my son will be 4 in September and my daughter will be 2 in November.
So do they have any tendency to be
make
creative?
A mess? We'll call it creative. The drawing on the walls, I'm like, why would you do that? Your dad would, okay, keep going. I'm like, stop. All right, go ahead. Yeah. No, they. You know, I bring them to the studio, and what I do. Oh, smart now. If you have kids, like, just clear out the garage, and just put a little canvas in the middle and some paints, and then just stand back and watch. Like, it's amazing watching them just go and just pour it everywhere and splatter it. And so they're just being fun with paint, being kids. So.
How cool is that? That's
good. Yeah.
All right. Let's give David a big hand.
Thank you.